Hello children, so this is the first unit of your bio class 9th, fundamental unit of life. This presentation will be on the cell and its components. So let's see the contents, what all we are gonna study in this particular chapter. So the contents are: what are living organisms made up of, structural organization of cell, cell organelles, isotonic, hypertonic and hypotonic solution, osmosis, plasmolysis and deplasmolysis, prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell. So let's start with the structure and function of a cell. So we are going to cover introduction and various cell organelles in this. First is cell membrane, then cytoplasm. Cytoplasm contains all these organelles mentioned there, and then we'll study in detail about the nucleus. First of all, let's start with cell. The cell was discovered by Robert Hooke in 1665 that made studies on strains of cork using a microscope. Cell theory was first set out by Schilden and Schön in 1839. So what are cells made up of? Cell is the basic unit of life. All living organisms are made up of cells. Cells are the building blocks of living bodies, as bricks are for building, like you have seen. So many bricks, they join and they combine, they form a big building, big structures. Like bricks are made up of cement, sand, stones, water, etc. Cells are also made up of smaller components called as organelles. This is the structure of cell. It consists of three main parts: cell membrane, cytoplasm and nucleus. So Robert Hooke was the person who discovered cell membrane in 1665. All living cells, prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic, you all know that they have a plasma membrane that encloses their contents and serves as a semi-porous barrier to the outside environment. This plasma membrane acts as a boundary, holding the cell constituents together and keeping other substances from entering. The plasma membrane is permeable to specific molecules and allows nutrients and other essential elements to enter and waste material to leave the cell. Small molecules such as oxygen, carbon dioxide, and water are able to pass freely across this membrane. Next, study about cytoplasm. So cytoplasm is basically the filling fluid. It is a life-giving substance which gives life to the cell. It is a fluid that fills the cell. It is a jelly-like material. Have you seen jelly? Its consistency is like a jelly. That is 80% water and usually clear in color. Cytoplasm contains water and protein material. And this is where the other cell organelles reside and where most of the cellular activities takes place. Cytoplasm contains dissolved nutrients and salts. It helps to dissolve the waste products also. Next one are ribosomes. Ribosomes were first observed in mid-1950 by a Romanian cell biologist, George Pallet, using an electronic microscope as dense particles or granules, for which he would win the Nobel Prize. The term ribosome was proposed by a scientist, Richard B. Roberts, in 1958. Now about their structure. Ribosomes are small, spherical, granular particles found either in free state or they are found attached to the surface of endoplasmic reticulum, giving it the appearance of roughness. So on the basis of this, that's why endoplasmic reticulum has been categorized into two categories: smooth as well as rough endoplasmic reticulum. The function of ribosome is to provide site for protein synthesis. So these are also called as protein factories of a cell. And they are divided into two subunits, larger one as well as the smaller one. Next one is lysosomes. Lysosomes were discovered by a Belgian researcher named as Christian D. Duve in 1949. They are organelles formed in the Golgi bodies. They are tiny, spherical, sac-like structures covered by a single membrane, scattered all over the cytoplasm. The main function is digestion. They contain powerful destructive enzymes capable of digesting all the organic material, and they are called as digestive bacs. The lysosomes present in WBCs are capable of digesting bacteria as well as viruses. During starvation, lysosomes digest proteins, fats and glycogen in the cytoplasm and supply energy to the cell. They are also capable of digesting worn out cell organelles or even digesting the entire damaged cell containing them. Hence, suicidal bag is a name that is often used for lysosomes. They are found in almost all animal cells except RBCs. The next one is mitochondria. Discovery of mitochondria dates back to 1840 when Richard Altman discovered mitochondria. These may be cylindrical, rod-shaped, or they can be spherical, and they are distributed in the cytoplasm. Each mitochondrion is bound by a double membrane, the inner one and the outer one. The inner membrane is folded into ridges called as cristae. They increase the surface area of the membrane. It is in the mitochondria that the sugar is finally burned during the cellular respiration. The energy thus released is stored as high energy chemicals called as ATPs, that is adenosine triphosphate. So they are termed as the powerhouse or power plant of the cell. Next one is endoplasmic reticulum. It was discovered in 1945 by Keith Potter and Albert Claude. It is an interconnected network of tubules, vesicles, and cisternae. This is a complex network of tubes, the lumen of which is filled with fluid. There are two types of endoplasmic reticulum, as I told you earlier. Tubes with a smooth surface are called smooth endoplasmic reticulum. They secrete lipids. And tubes with spherical bodies, that is ribosomes attached on them, are called as rough endoplasmic reticula. The endoplasmic reticulum is responsible for the production of the proteins and lipid components of most of the cell organelles. They contain a great amount of folds, but the membrane forms a single sheet enclosing a single closed sac. This internal space is called as endoplasmic reticulum lumen. The next one are Golgi apparatus. They are also called as Golgi body or Golgi complex and were identified in 1898 by the Italian physician Camillo Golgi, and that's why they are named after him. Due to its fairly large size, the Golgi apparatus was one of the first organelles to be discovered. It is a collection of vesicles and folded membranes in a cell, usually connected to ER. Golgi apparatus is typically comprised of a series of 5 to 8 cup-shaped membrane-covered sacs called as cisternae, and it stores and later transports the proteins manufactured in the ER. Next one are plastids. So chloroplast, show me the green. So Konstantin Mereshkovsky, a Russian botanist, discovered chloroplast in 1905. These are the food producers of the cell, and they are only found in plant cells. That's why they are green, and animal cells do not have chloroplast. Remember students, animal cell do not contain chloroplast. We are not green. Every green plant you see is working to convert the energy of the sun into sugars. They use a process called as photosynthesis to get the job done. Plants are the basis of life on earth. They create sugars, and the byproduct of that process is oxygen that we breathe. That process happens in chloroplast. But mitochondria, it works in the opposite direction and break down the sugars and nutrients that the cell receives. Two membranes contain and protect the inner parts of the chloroplast. These double membrane bound organelles enclose additional membrane called as thylakoids. You can see these structures in the diagram. The disc-shaped thylakoids possess an interior space, and they are stacked to form grana, which are suspended in the stroma of the chloroplast. The next organelle is nucleus. It was the first organelle to be discovered. A.V. Leeuwenhoek in 1632 observed the nucleus in the red blood cells of salmon. Salmon is a fish. The nucleus is the largest cellular organelle in animals, also sometimes referred to as the control center. The nucleus is spherical in shape and separated from the cytoplasm by a double membrane structure called as nuclear envelope. It is composed of the following structures: nuclear membrane, nucleoplasm, nucleolus, and chromatin network. So let's study about the four parts individually. First of all, nuclear membrane. The nuclear envelope isolates and protects the cell DNA from various molecules. It is a double-layered membrane which separates the nucleoplasm from the cytoplasm. The nuclear membrane has minute pores which allow the selective transfer of material between nucleoplasm and cytoplasm. Students, the fluid present inside nucleus is called nucleoplasm, and the fluid present in the cell except nucleus is called cytoplasm. So the second part is nucleoplasm. Within the nuclear membrane, completely filling up the space, is a clear semi-solid granular substance, or you can say matrix also, called as nucleoplasm. The nucleolus and the chromatin network lie suspended in this nucleoplasm. Third one is nucleolus. It is a dense spherical granule found in the nucleus, which contains RNA, which is called as ribonucleic acid, and is responsible for protein synthesis in the cytoplasm. The next one is chromatin network. So these are very fine thread-like coiled filaments uniformly distributed in the nucleoplasm. At the time of cell division, the chromatin becomes thick and ribbon-like and are called as chromosomes. The chromosomes contain genes which are composed of DNA called as deoxyribonucleic acid. These genes are responsible for storing and transmitting the heredity characteristics from one generation to another. Gene is the functional unit of a chromosome. They are arranged in single linear order along the chromosome. So let's study about the functions of the nucleus. Nucleus is the master organelle of all living cells. It is also called as the brain of the cell. All the major functions of the cell are performed under the instructions of nucleus. Like we are having principal in our schools, on whose orders the teachers as well as the students work. In the same way, nucleus is the main component of a cell, and all the cell organelles, they take the instruction from nucleus. Storage of heredity material. The genes in the form of long and thin DNA strands, referred to as chromatins, it stores them. DNA replication takes place inside the nucleus. The storage of proteins and RNA, it happens in nucleolus. Exchange of heredity molecules, that is DNA and RNA, between the nucleus and rest of the cell, it takes place with the help of this. Production of ribosomes, you know, the protein factories. Selective transportation of regulatory factors and energy molecules through nuclear pores. It happens in nucleus. Next ones are vacuoles, that is the storage bins to the cell. There are storage bubbles found in the cell. A.B. Leeuwenhoek probably first saw them when he was studying bacteria. They are found in both animal as well as plant cells, but they are much larger in plant cells because they store their food and we don't. Vacuoles might store food or any variety of nutrients a cell might need to survive. They can even store waste products also, so the rest of the cell is protected from the contamination. Eventually, those waste products would be sent out of the cell afterwards. There is a membrane that surrounds a mass of fluid called as the tonoplast. In that fluid are the nutrients or waste products. Plants may also use vacuoles to store water, and these tiny water bags help to support the plant. So next is osmosis. Have you ever forgotten to water a plant for a few days, then come back to find your plant a wilted mess? When a plant wilts, it does so because water moves out of its cells, causing them to lose the internal pressure called as the turgor pressure that normally supports the plant. Now the point is, why does water leave the cells? The amount of water outside the cells drops as the plant loses water, but the same quantity of ions and other particles remains in the space outside the cells. This increase in solute or dissolved particles concentration pulls the water out of the cells into the extracellular space in a process which is called as osmosis. So osmosis is the net movement of water across a semi-permeable membrane from an area of the lower solute concentration to an area of higher solute concentration. We will also study a term associated with it, tonicity. The ability of an extracellular solution to make water move into or out of a cell by osmosis is known as its tonicity. Children, cells are simply a solution surrounded by a semi-permeable bag, the plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is able to keep solutes from diffusing across the cell membrane. While it allows water to diffuse by osmosis across the membrane into the cytoplasm. Membrane is embedded with special proteins called as the membrane transport proteins, like you can see in the diagram, a green one. Others are aquaporin, which regulate the solute content to ensure that they do not dry up or become too full of water. On the basis of this, we are having three types of solutions. First one is hypotonic. Hypotonic solution has a higher concentration of dissolved particles than a cell. Like you can see in the diagram, the cell is having 10% salt concentration and the outside it is 20% salt concentration. So water from the cell will move out of it, and this means the water concentration is lower than that of cell, and water flows out of the cell, so the cell will shrivel and eventually die. The next one is hypotonic solution. The word hypo means less. In this case, there are less solute molecules outside the cell, so water will move into the cell. Like you can see in the diagram, the outside solution is 10% salt and the inside 20% of salt. So the water will move into the cell. Next one is isotonic. A solution is isotonic to a cell if it has the same concentration of dissolved particles as the cell. This means that water concentration is also the same and water molecules move into and out of the cell at an equal rate in this isotonic solution, and the cell size will remain the same. Like you can see in the diagram, inside the cell there is 10% concentration of salt and outside also. So water goes in both directions. Plant cells usually consist of a thick cell wall that functions by holding them upright and also prevents them losing their shape. The plasma membrane, cytoplasm, and all other cell organelles function together to keep the plant active. We just read about the vacuoles. A fluid-filled membrane-bound organelle located within the cytoplasm holds the water in the plant cell. In certain conditions, plant cells do not get a sufficient amount of water, or there is severe loss of water from the cell. This results in total shrinkage of the plant cell and it is called as plasmolysis. So plasmolysis is the process in which cell lose water in a hypotonic solution. So these are few examples of plasmolysis: shrinkage of vegetable in hypotonic solution, and blood cells shrink when they are placed in hypertonic conditions. When the plasmolyzed cell is placed in a hypotonic solution, that is the solution in which solute concentration is less than the cell sap, water travels into the cell due to the higher concentration of water outside the cell. The cell swells up and becomes turgid. This is called as deplasmolysis. Have a look on this diagram. The cells placed in distilled water, they will swell up and burst. And the cells placed in concentrated salt solution, they will shrink and will shrivel. The next topic is prokaryotes and eukaryotes. The distinction between prokaryotes and eukaryotes is considered to be the most important distinction among the group of organisms. Eukaryotic cells contain membrane-bound organelles such as nucleus, just we read, and while prokaryotic cells do not. Differences in cellular structure of prokaryotes and eukaryotes include the presence of mitochondria and chloroplast, cell wall, and structure of chromosomal DNA. Prokaryotes were the only form of life on Earth for millions of years until more complicated eukaryotic cells came into being through the process of evolution. Now, cells fall into one of two broad categories, prokaryotic and eukaryotic. Single cell organisms of the domain bacteria and archaea are classified as prokaryotes. Prokaryote means before nucleus. Animal cells like plant cells, fungi, and protista are eukaryotes, and eu means true. A prokaryotic cell is a simple single-celled unicellular organism that lacks a nucleus or any other membrane-bound organelle, like you can see in the picture shown. This is the picture of a bacteria. Bacteria have a cell wall made up of peptidoglycan, comprised of sugar and amino acids, and many have a polysaccharide capsule also. The cell wall acts as an extra layer of protection, helps the cell maintain its shape, and prevents dehydration. Capsule enables the cell to attach to the surfaces in its environment. Some prokaryotes have flagella, pili, or fimbriae. Flagella are used for locomotion, while most pili are used to exchange genetic material during a type of reproduction called as conjugation. A eukaryotic cell is a cell that has a membrane-bound nucleus and other membrane-bound compartments or sacs called as organelles, which have specialized functions. The eukaryotic word means true kernel or true nucleus because of the presence of membrane-bound nucleus in their cells. So here is the picture of a eukaryotic cell. And just now we read about eukaryotic cell, the various organelles we read about. So this is a picture, you can go through it in detail. In the center there is a nucleus, then the blue colored are mitochondrions, the pink color is the Golgi apparatus, orange color one is the endoplasmic reticulum. There are ribosomes also, lysosome also, and other organelles also. So at 0.1 to 5.0 micrometer in diameter, prokaryotic cells are significantly smaller than eukaryotic cells. They have diameters ranging from 10 to 100 micrometer. The small size of the prokaryotes allows ions and organic molecules that enter them to quickly spread to other parts of the cell. Similarly, any waste produced within the cell can quickly move out. However, large eukaryotic cells have evolved different structural adaptations to enhance cellular transport. So this is the picture depicting the cell sizes and cell range. You can go through it. These are the relative sizes of cell on a logarithmic scale. They can be seen through naked eye or light microscope or electron microscope also. Like the ostrich egg we can see through naked eye. Chicken egg we can see through naked eye. But with light microscope you can see plant cell and animal cell. With electron microscope you can see flu viruses or proteins or various subcellular organelles you can see through electron microscope. So with this we covered the whole chapter. I hope it was easy for you. In case of any doubt, you can ask in the comment section. See you all in the next one. Till the time, stay connected. Bye.